Good morning, Elevate Church. Hopefully your drive this morning wasn't as exciting as that obstacle course, but it sure does feel like it this last week. So if you've made it today, obviously your vehicle started or you bust, thank you either way. This last week has been a trial, especially for people working outside. We thank God for each and every one of you. That is horrible. All right, I want to open up with scripture. Proverbs 22 verses 7. The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for everything, right down to that last breath we just had. Please open our hearts to your word in relation to money and how it ties into our faith. Amen. So the Bible contains 2,350 verses about money or possessions, which is massive. And 15% of what Jesus had to say had to do with money. So if Jesus himself thought it was that important, I think we should as well. So instead of going through all 2,350 verses, although I'm sure you would all love to sit here for 10 or 11 hours, we can condense it. Thanks to Dave Ramsey, he did a sermon on this. He condensed it down to 5 basic principles, and that's what he teaches in his course. So those 5 principles are: live on a written budget, avoid debt, foster high-quality relationships, save and invest, and be incredibly generous. Those 5 things. And we're going to go through each one of them. So if you don't like these principles, it doesn't matter. They're not Luke principles. They're Bible principles. Take it up with the big man upstairs, not me. Don't find me in the parking lot, please. Number 1, live on a written budget. Luke 14, verses 28 through 30. That's ironic, not purposeful, but ironic nonetheless. It says, "For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count out the cost, whether he has enough to build it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, 'This man began to build and was unable to finish.'" So if you travel down to the Caribbean, you'll see a lot of houses that are built up one floor and they still have rebar poking out of the roof as if they were going to build another level. You see it everywhere, all over the suburbs. And the reason is so they can avoid taxes. The house is still being built, technically. That's not what it's talking about here, though. It's talking about running out of money and not being able to finish. So what happened is that the man obviously didn't budget. He didn't have the money. Budgeting is super important. If you owned a company, and we'll call it You Incorporated, fill in your name, and the person in charge of running the company spent money the way that you do, would you fire him or keep him? I would fire him. That man eats way too many Tim Hortons donuts and is wasting company money. How are we supposed to pay off debt, feed our kids, pay bills, save and invest, and be incredibly generous without a plan? We can't do it. We're not smart enough. We're too impulsive enough. So having a written monthly budget is a great first step to actually realizing how much money you're bringing in, and sadly, how much is going out just as fast or faster. Proverbs 21, verse 5. The plans of the diligent lead surely to abundance, but everyone who is hasty comes only to poverty. It's interesting to note that it says the plans of the diligent. It doesn't say the great income of the diligent. It doesn't say the incredible work ethic of the diligent. It says the plans of the diligent. It doesn't say that the person already had a bunch of money. It says that they planned and they got there, which is interesting. Not what abundance the diligent have that makes them diligent. It's the other way around. It's the diligence that leads to abundance. So point number 2, avoid debt. Proverbs 22, verse 7. This is our opening verse, and it's super important, so I'll say it again. The rich rules over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender. So debt, car payments, credit cards, these are all things that all of us have. Why? 50 to 80 years ago, these things didn't even exist. But now in today's culture, we are entrenched in debt, right from the very start. We owe on our smartphones, we owe on our education, we owe on everything. We have a credit card with every bank to get scene points and fly points and all kinds of points, but you never hear anyone using them. Sure, you get a movie, but it costs you $8,000, whatever. Why is it so normal to us? Our great-grandparents, or my grandparents, would never have done stuff like this. If they didn't have the cash in hand, they never would have bought. A recent statistic shows that over half of Canadians, right down to everyone in this room, are $500 or less from bankruptcy. So if you suddenly stopped having income, you have less than $500 saved up, and you're done. Wow. So credit cards don't count as your backup plan. That's someone else's money. That's not yours. Less than $500 savings from bankruptcy. That's scary. That's really scary. Debt is not healthy. It's really toxic. It's a poison that leaks into every aspect of our lives. Because if you're not worried about your monthly payments at the end of the month, like I am, about credit cards or cars or a mortgage, then if you're not worried about that, well, A, you don't know about it, which is even scarier. But B, these are all things that we have. You don't need debt. And no one tells us that anymore. You don't need it. You don't need it to build up a great credit score, and you don't need a great credit score either, which is mind-blowing to us. Anyways, all about that credit score and all about this can go further in depth with Dave Ramsey's course, Financial Peace University, which we do here at this church every once in a while. It's a great thing to sign up for, but it goes into all of this in detail. Romans 13:8 says very clearly, "Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt of love to one another." Right there in the Bible it says don't have debt, period. So why aren't we doing it? Do we just ignore it, or do we just listen to the culture instead of what the Bible says? It's interesting to think about. We are commanded to not let debt live in our lives. And here we are in our neck, up to our neck in it. So I think for this point, let us learn for this new year to hate debt. Not embrace it. It's not a backup plan. Debt doesn't like you. Stop liking debt. Period. So these are some of the practical ways to positively affect your finances. Stop using credit cards. Stop going into debt. Start using cash. If you have to, use debit cards. And you say, why cash? And the cash is important because according to a survey that was done by McDonald's way back in the 50s and 60s when cards were first coming out, people spend 20% more with a card than they do with cash. So if you're going to McDonald's, so McDonald's is one of the smartest groups in the world, everybody. They know people and how they spend. If you go to McDonald's and you have a $20 bill, you're going to spend under $20. If you go with a credit card or a debit card, it's very easy to get the large fry, the large Coke, the McFlurry, ooh, and that brand new chocolate croissant. And it's easy to go over $20. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. The cash keeps you under a limit. So that's some of the ways that we can positively navigate this course, this new year, as a ninja. Stop using credit cards. Let's be wise about our hard-earned money and be really diligent when it comes to financial matters. Point number three, foster high-quality relationships. This doesn't sound like a financial thing, but if we dive into it, it is. 1 Corinthians 15:33. Do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. So we say things in North America like, one bad apple spoils the barrel. The Italians say, sleep with the dogs and you'll catch the fleas. These things apply. So you become like those you hang around, which is why it's super important to surround yourself with brothers and sisters in Christ who are mature and diligent in every aspect of their lives, including financially. You can learn from them. People who live their lives with humility and diligence in all things, including finances, are people who can positively influence you to do the same in your life. So what's an example? People who pressure you on the weekends to go out and spend money with them just to have a good time are not the kind of people you want to hang out with. You're going to go into debt for the wrong reason. Coffee and Walmart croissants are always welcome at my house. You can come over anytime. Coffee and Walmart croissants. I should probably have checked before the open invitation, but it's there. Hang around people who don't press you to spend money. It's less about brand names and more about board games. That's my own saying. And as Pastor Evan says, you can hashtag it. Less brand names and more board games. Dave Ramsey's famous saying is that we have been hoodwinked into spending money we don't have on things we don't need for people we don't like. We spend money we don't have on things we don't need to impress people we don't like. Number four, save and invest. Proverbs 21, verses 20. Precious treasure and oil are in a wise man's dwelling, but a foolish man devours it. So it's talking about saving things aside for the future and not devouring it all in the present. So not everything that we have should be devoured presently, in the present. We should always have in the mind the future and how it's going to affect us later. Once you've applied the other principles that we just went through, this is the next one. So you should be, first of all, stop getting into debt. You should pay off your debt. And then once that happens, you should start saving and investing with the money that is yours. This concept is well-rooted in Scripture. So in Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30, Jesus goes through the parable of the talents. And the master has three servants, and the master is going away for a long time. It doesn't say how long, but it's probably years. And he has eight talents, if my math is working, in minus 30. Eight talents, which are kind of like the equivalent of a $1,000 bill now. And he gives five to one servant, he gives two to the other, and he gives one to the last servant. And it says each according to his ability. So the master knew what they were going to do. It's kind of a foreshadow. And the master left. And the servant with five talents went and invested it. And with interest, it gained another five more talents, which is significant. So he doubled his master's money. The second servant did the same thing. He invested his two talents, and it gained two talents more. The last servant, however, fearful of his master and fearful of losing or having the last talent stolen, just buried it. When the master returned, he asked what they had done with the money. And the first two servants gladly show their master what they've done. They've gained the interest, they were smart with it, they saved and invested it, and they doubled. And the master says, good and faithful servant, enter the joy of your master. But with the last servant, the one who was fearful of his master, who hid the money, even though he didn't lose it, he didn't lose the money, he still had it, the master was furious and said, shouldn't you have at least invested it and earned some interest on it? And he cast the servant out. So if we just devour or even just hold on to what God's given us and do nothing with it, we are not the good servants. We have to wisely use it, wisely save it, and wisely invest it. Okay, point number five. I'm going through these too quickly. Be incredibly generous. 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. It's sad to see this verse twisted so often, but it does have a really good meaning. Self-sacrifice and generosity are key elements of a healthy life in the Spirit. They should be core elements of who we are as Christians. We should be excited not only to help each other in the room, but everyone we come in contact with out in our day-to-day lives. Jesus, of course, as always, is our greatest example. And even though Jesus wasn't born into a family of wealth, he had the spirit of generosity. He would give of his time, for example, holding and blessing children, even when it seemed like there was much more important things to do. He would walk for days by foot just to help someone grieve, or in one case, help them raise their loved one from the dead. Jesus was self-giving in every opportunity he had, and as the greatest example of what that looked like, the Messiah, our promised king, the Lord of the universe, who spoke planets into existence, knelt down and washed his disciples' feet in an act of self-sacrifice. and they wore sandals. It was disgusting. Trust me. I hate feet. I even hate even talking about feet. But do you see the pattern? You don't need millions of dollars to be generous. You need the spirit of generosity. You don't need the abundance. You need the plans. So imagine what a generous spirit could do inside of some of us who have learned to be diligent. Just the spirit of generosity inside of a diligent person can mean a lot. $1,000 car can make a huge difference to a single mom. A huge difference. Allows her to get a job, and so on and so forth. Just $1,000. Imagine what we could all do if we learned to be diligent and just help out in the ways that we can. We could significantly impact our society. Instead of being in debt, we could be diligent and actually live the way that Christ wants us to. Time for a personal story. So I had heard about this pay it forward thing on China FM. And what happens is you go through the Tim Hortons drive-thru and you pay for the person behind you. And I thought I'd try it for the first time. This was a couple years ago. And I pulled up and I was determined to get not only my own coffee, but whatever the order was behind me. I didn't care. Although I admit I did look to see if it was a minivan full of kids. But either way, I was determined. I was going to buckle down and I was just going to do it. I was going to be generous. And I made my order and then I pulled up to the window. And before I could even offer the card to pay, and offer to pay for the person behind me, the person in front of me had taken care of both of our orders. I didn't have a chance to get be generous yet before it was already given back. And that is a true story. I was in shock. I was like, oh, this is cool. You do reap what you sow. And I'm not saying that in a way that you should believe that you should do everything with looking in the mirror, looking for something back. Or I should always be in other people. But it is a biblical concept. You do reap what you sow, even if it's in a different way. So, how can we be generous in our day-to-day lives? The person at work who you know is having a bad day, how can you help that person? How can you be generous to that person? If she needs a blessing in her life in a particular way, and you know you can help, if you have the responsibility, you can respond, and you have the ability to respond, then it's your responsibility to help. Or how can you help here, right here in your local church? How can you be generous here? We should be intentionally, annoyingly generous people. That's the way Jesus would want it. So, how do we navigate the new year like a ninja or like a warrior? A, live on a plan. We're doing a review. We have to know that there will be obstacles and we should budget so we don't fall short of said obstacles. Number two, we should avoid debt at all costs. Debt's like that water jet that they spray at the competitors to knock them off the obstacles. Get you back in the pool and swim all the way back and restart. That's what debt's like. So when you choose debt, you're just letting go. Number three, quality relationships. If you think those people don't have coaches, you're nuts. They need people who have A, done the course, or B, have just finished the course to help walk them through it. Four, save and invest. Are you going to have enough energy when you reach the red buzzer at the end to walk off without fainting? Are you going to save some of your energy? Are you going to invest it properly? Are you going to plan for the future? Don't spend all your energy on the first obstacle. These are all analogies. I'm putting it to you guys to make it work. Number five, be incredibly generous. Give it all you got. Doesn't matter to whom or to what. Give it all you got. Be generous, overabundant, annoyingly, like, prosperous, generous people. There, I made that work for obstacles. I have one last point that I added this morning. I woke up really early, and this was on my heart, and I wanted to tie this in. So this new year, 2020, we're looking at it like an obstacle course, but it's a section of a bigger obstacle course. Every year is a section, a section, a section, a section, and our whole life's an obstacle course, beginning to end. Because we have obstacles all the way through. And we all have different obstacles. Some of us have to jump over a divorce. Some of us have to climb over a pool of anxiety and self-loathing. We all have different obstacles. All our courses are different. And we cannot change where our course takes us, and we cannot change the obstacles in our course the same way we can't change our lives in any way. We just run it, and we do it and we push through. I mean, you can work hard and apply these principles, and the obstacles you face, you'll jump easier and quicker, but you can't change the obstacles themselves. You can't predict what's going to happen, and there's always going to be surprises. So my last point is actually more of a warning. I'm saying, even though we're talking about money and finances, that shouldn't be the focus of our lives. Money should not be our course master. It should be a tool that we use to hurdle the obstacles. The money is a tool and nothing more. And you say, well, don't worry, I don't got any money. Neither do I. But when you say that I'm not rich, if you have $100 in your bank account and food in your fridge when you get home, you're in the top 5% of the planet. That you guys are rich. And what does Jesus say about the rich in Matthew 19, verses 16? He talks about the story of a young man who came and said, Jesus, what do I do to enter the kingdom of heaven? What do I have to do? And Jesus says, no one is good except the Father. There's nothing you can do to get into heaven. I'm paraphrasing here, I'm not quoting. And Jesus says, you have to sell all your possessions, give to the poor, and follow me. And the young man ends up walking away crying because he had many possessions. Just like that, crying. Exactly. Because he had so much possessions and it was precious to him, and he didn't want to give it up. So, and then Jesus goes on to say to his disciples, he says, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for the rich to enter heaven. And my friends, we are the rich. When it comes to planet Earth, we are the rich. So in Matthew 6:24, it says that no man can serve two masters. Either you serve God or you serve something else. And it mentions money specifically. Money can be a master to us. We can serve it and obsess over it and go our whole lives trying to chase it. So money, especially here in North America, has become our master. Money is the number one cause of divorce. It's the number one cause of war. And it's the number one definition of success that most people will say. So why is it so big? Many people have let money become the course master. And we can't even do anything about it. We're born into this system of money and greed. So do not let money be the course master. Let it remain a tool that you use to hurdle obstacles. Nothing more, nothing less. Let me tell you that learning diligence and acquiring knowledge about finances and learning to be wise is extremely important, in as far as it keeps money a tool. Anything more is dangerous, not only to our faith, but also for our eternal destiny. Jesus should be the only course master. So, if we're the rich, but we keep Jesus number one, and we truly let him direct the course of our lives, then we are safe. So what's our alternative if money is usually the course master for us? What's the alternative? What is the point of running a course that's full of greed if it only takes us to hell? There's no point in trying to work so hard for obstacles that are taking us nowhere, right? So you can't change the course you're on, because we're helpless as it is. Only Jesus can change the course you're on. He can take you right from the money course and put you in his course. You can't make that switch. Jesus does. So you only run your course. He says that even in the course that he gives you, you'll have trials and tribulations, but they'll become learning lessons and training sessions. There's another hashtag. I did it. That's two. Learning lessons and training sessions. So it says in John 3:16 that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. That's moving from the sin course to the Jesus course. And it's because he loves you. He wants to move you to the new course. So when we move to Jesus' new course, he gives purpose to every pain where we didn't have that before. And he gives us a hope that the course runs somewhere good. So now that you're on the Jesus course, at least Even though there's obstacles, your course is going up to heaven. Super important. At least it's going somewhere and you have hope at the end of it. He is our good Father, and suddenly every obstacle is something that we can learn from. And it helps to run the course the same way that Jesus did. All we have to do to switch course is believe and repent. That's it. Believe that Jesus came down as a man and lived a perfect life. He ran the perfect course so that he could sacrifice himself for your sins. Believe in his sacrifice for you, his love for you, his rising from the dead 3 days later in an act of complete power for you, and repent. It's really hard for Jesus to move you from the sin course to the saved course if you still want to run the sin course and you're still holding on, right? You have to let go. You have to repent. And you have to turn around. It says in John 1:9. Oh, I have it on my phone. Sorry, I should have had it out. That's my bad. It says in John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. He says if we ask sincerely, he will do it and he can give us a new course for our lives. And it says in Hebrews 12:1, it says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. That course is right there in the Bible. And it's something that we can all do if we believe and repent. So I'll just say a prayer. Not that saying a prayer can save you, but sincerity and a belief in Jesus Christ will. So I'm not going to ask you guys to raise hands or walk to the front, but if today is that moment and you feel a call to switch course, let Jesus do it for you, because he can, and he is faithful and just and will purify you and save you. Dear Jesus, we need you. We don't want to run a course that goes nowhere. Please take my life. Thank you that you will give me a purpose and that everything I go through has a reasoning behind it that you know. We thank you. I repent of my sins and I want to start again, fresh, for you. Thank you for the grace that you have given, that I can switch course and now have something to look forward to. In Jesus' name, amen.